Now, each one of those golden dots holds thousands of stories. And if we can't see what lies beneath those dots, we can't really understand emancipation. So we're going to zoom in on the place that Will and I worked on for a long time that I can't quite reach in the Shenandoah Valley of Virginia, not too far from the Pennsylvania line, the places where some of those other newspapers were coming from. And if we look at Augusta County, Virginia, Shenandoah Valley, if we bear down to the stories of individual people and families, we can see how people held in bondage created new lives for themselves. Something that's frustrating to me is that there have been revolutions that have taken place in our understanding of emancipation, freedom, reconstruction, but nobody knows about them because everybody remembers Gone with the Wind because it was such a great story and everybody's seen it, and people sort of think Sherman marched through and then there was reconstruction, forgetting the 2 years in between that didn't happen. And looking at it from the viewpoint of white people, what if we imagine that story again in a way that we don't have a movie like Glory about black soldiers? We don't have a great representation of what freedom looked like. The most dramatic event in American history really has not been represented very much in the great forms of art and so forth. What might we see if we try to look at it with history in some new eyes? Well, one of the things that we can do is we can begin with some of the stories that that we think we know already. If you go and look at project on the Freedmen's Bureau, you can see that we have writing in and telling about the freedmen. This is one white man writing to another. The condition of the freedmen in this district is generally good. Bureau, Freedmen's Bureau is great. Freedmen have learned that we protected the exercise of unquestionable rights. The former masters, now knowing they may not ill-treat or unjustly, use them with impunity. Freedmen, however, have a vague dread of being soon deprived of the assistance now given by this Bureau and are thus repressed in their aspirations for manhood through the fears of being left at the mercy of implacable neighbors who now secretly vaunt the terrible things they will do when the Yankees are gone. So it's great. Things are going great. It's just this vague fear that everything they have is going to be taken away. The freedmen are generally at work under verbal contracts terminating at Christmas. They don't want to have written contracts because they can hardly be induced to look beyond that time. But we hope that things are going to get better. But how scary would this be? Among the old and infirm and women with three or more little children, there is now considerable suffering, which will increase with the approach of winter. Think about this, worrying if you even have enough firewood to keep your children and yourself alive. People look back on it and think about Scarlett having the indignity of having to wear that dress made out of a curtain. Okay, but there are people who literally are worrying, are their children going to freeze to death because there's not enough firewood? Partial issues of rations prevent starvation, but they need the wood. Local authorities can't do anything. But that's what it looks like from one white bureaucrat to another. You read the white newspaper, and it's a very familiar, just a list of ridiculous things about Reconstruction. What an insane notion. Something's going to happen here that's not happened anywhere else in the world. We're going to take people who were enslaved and who were prevented from learning how to read, and they're not only going to become instantly free, but they are going to become voters and even office holders. This is a violation, the white Southerners and many white Northerners told themselves, of God's law, of the law of nations, of common sense. And this is what we've based a lot of our understanding of Reconstruction on, because all the newspapers are run by the white guys in the South. And it's all an attack on Reconstruction. And that's why many people carrying around in their heads this idea that Reconstruction was a horrible time of corruption and injustice and all this, because these are the sources that we have, making fun of all the black people who are putting together petitions, the Freedmen's Bureau bill, and all these different kinds of things. But what if we looked at it from the viewpoint of black people themselves? Burton writes a letter to the Freedmen's Bureau. Very short. Not all those pages and pages of boilerplate about rights and so forth. She just says, Horace Bucker sold my two sons. Happened hundreds of thousands of times in this story of emancipation. How can I find my children? I am now living in Stanton, a widow and alone, and would like very much to see them. Look for them in the census. Fine. Third line, there's Isabella Burton. Black person in this white household, still alone, still a widow. Entire historical record of Isabella Burton, what we know about her. What if we were able to, by using these mappings and visualizations, to learn more about people like Isabella Burton, if we weren't frustrated by just the fact that there are not many instances of where these letters and so forth, but we extrapolated. So if you go through and you look for the Freedmen's Bureau records and you count them, what is it that the black people thought Reconstruction is about? Look what they want. What they want, we want to have our own church. We want our children. We want our own school. Okay? That they want wife and husband. But what's freedom about? Freedom is about the most primal human contacts. Things that we should be able to see if we could look at the records with enough imagination and care, that we might be able to see what kind of patterns that these make.